So grateful to be invited to do this Dharma talk tonight, and appreciate you being here. Appreciate you all being there. Can you hear me okay out there? Can y'all hear me? that's more of the point. I really am so grateful for this opportunity to speak about this koan, but before I get there even, I'm so grateful for that reception that you gave to Valerie and me and to Brian, to our newcoming executive director. It was a beautiful party outdoors, and great food, great music, great company, and I've just been on a high ever since. It's been such an embrace. Thank you. And I'm sorry Henry isn't feeling up to his usual self tonight. So Henry, hope you feel better. So the koan I'm going to speak about tonight is case 32 of the Mumin Khan, or the Gateless Gate, a non-Buddhist questions Buddha. Now, I gave a talk on this, or I gave a teisho on this same koan back in August at the Kinshikai in Madrid. If you aren't familiar with what Kinshikai is, that's this gathering of the Sanbo Zen roshis and teachers and assistant teachers and senior students that are invited. And it's just a wonderful event. We didn't get to do it for the last few years because of COVID. The last time was 2019. And in 20, we didn't do it at all. And in 21, we did it kind of Zoom. Well, we did a Zoom Kinshikai, which was great to do. But to get back together again like that was great homecoming. And we had to reduce the numbers to about 38 people. But anyway, familiar people. I've been going there since 2014, Valerie, I don't know, since 2000 or something like that. It's been going on a long time, and deep friendships, and people from all over, a lot of people from Europe. And so there we were, and Kinshikai is neat because it's, you know, one third or one half session, and then another half or so of Kinshikai or training or koan study. Very lively, often very funny, very deep, touching. And then we also get to socialize, you know, at meals, and there's an outing or two. It's sort of the best of two or three worlds. So I was invited by the Roshi to give this talk. Really delightful to accept that invitation. And I brought this koan for that. And, you know, they say you learn from your mistakes, right? So I learned a lot, I think, from that talk. And I hope to impart some of that to you, but who knows, maybe I'll learn a lot tonight too. Mistake after mistake. Get a little organized here. I used to hear this instruction, and Valerie would often give it. If you're new to hearing teisho, Dharma talks, or even if you're an old hand, it's nice to listen with an open mind. Or with the third ear, kind of. No need to analyze or try to remember. And if anything does happen to strike you, let it resonate. And, or just listen any way you like. It's okay. So first, listen to this. Did you get it? If you got that, you got this koan. And I'll read the case to you now. A non-Buddhist questions Buddha. The case. A non-Buddhist, in all earnestness, asked the world-honored one, I do not ask about words. I do not ask about no words. The world-honored one just sat still. The non-Buddhist praised him, saying, the world-honored one, in his great benevolence and great mercy, has opened the clouds of my delusion and enabled me to enter the way. Then, bowing, he took his leave. Ananda asked Buddha, what did the non-Buddhist realize that made him praise you so much? The world-honored one replied, he is just like a fine horse that runs even at the shadow of a whip. So, I love this card. There are three characters here. First, the non-Buddhist. There are translations where this non-Buddhist is called the Hindu or the outsider, or more pejoratively, the heretic, or more kindly, perhaps, probably a philosopher. And I like to kind of take the latter idea about who the non-Buddhist is. First of all, he has his question sounds like a philosopher's question, but he's also described as in all earnestness, the way so many koans have a monk coming to a master in all earnestness. So this frame of mind, I think, is important in understanding what's going on in this little drama. In all earnestness, the non-Buddhist asked, I don't ask about words, I don't ask about no words. A kind of typical philosophical question. Another translation is, I don't ask about words about existence, nor words about non-existence, or words about being, or words about non-being. And philosophers in those days like to have this phrase I love, apposition of opposites. You know, they love to set up this tautology or this conundrum and say stuff like, is there existence or is there non-existence? Or is there both existence and non-existence? Or is there neither existence nor non-existence? You choose. And whatever you say, you're done. But I don't think he was coming at the Buddha with this kind of challenge. I think what I see here is perhaps he has been practicing the jhanas, as Henry was talking about at last Sunday's OL, and got to those higher levels, or up the ladder of the jhanas, and got to that point of neither existence nor non-existence, and it just could not break through. And so he finds himself in front of this world-honored one and asks him this essential question. It's a wonderful question. And the Buddha's answer, he just sat still. We don't know how long he sat. You know, was it moments? Was it minutes? Was it hours? Days? Is he still sitting? Yes, he's still sitting. He's still sitting. But maybe I'm getting ahead of myself there. He answered perfectly. Not only the non-Buddhist's question, but every question. He answered You know, who am I? Why are we here? What happens when we die? Where do we go? Why do we suffer? How do we stop? What's the average wing velocity of an unladen African swallow? Why did I move to Santa Fe? He's still just sitting. And his sitting isn't just answering the questions. His sitting is the question. It's everything, actually. Just sitting still, answering all those questions. I've gotten a little bit sensitive about the word just, and when I find myself using it, I often stop and correct myself. It's, you hear, just do it, just sit, just say no, just show up. And you know, those are all fine, but you know, it's kind of, you know, the feeling I get sometimes when I say it is like I'm simplifying, oversimplifying, reducing. And that is not what this just sat still is. There's nothing but the sitting. There's nothing but just that. Just sitting still. It's everything. It's even not sitting still is in there. Wondering if I should go sit is in there. That's there. That's in there. It's everything. Shikantaza, you know, translated just sitting. How simple is that? Not. I mean, how hard is that? Or how profound is that? Give it a try. It's not complicated, but you know, neither is running a marathon. That's not complicated. Neither is life. It's just life. Happens all by itself. So the world honored one just sat still. What a beautiful sentence that is. Where can you see the world honored one sitting right now? Every moment, every thought, every sensation, every gesture, the wall, the flowers, the Zoom gallery, just sitting still. When I was at Kinshikai and you're kind of processing the Taisho afterwards that had was flawed, and I was talking to Henry about it. He said, this regret that you're feeling, that's Buddha sitting still. And he gave me this as a koan. Just everything that comes up, especially when you are reflecting on your talk, that's Buddha sitting still. I've used it since. It's great. And I'm recalling, lately I've been recalling something that happened to me about a year ago over the course of a few weeks. I would go running in the woods when we were back in Dallas through these wonderful creeks with lots and lots of forests that run through the city, and they make parks out of them. And I like to run in these paths, hilly paths. And so I was out running one day and in the woods, all alone, running uphill, and a trip to fell, hit a rock or a root or something, just fell flat. And it was a little bit, you know, flabbergasted, a little bit, I don't know, put out with myself, you know, and hurt my hands and this. And then it just sort of, I realized, there's no one here to see this, and it's pretty quiet, and just got up and ran on, and that was it. And then, I don't know, a week or so later, I was running in those same woods again, up that same hill, remembering having fallen and being really careful, turning the corner, and then there's this real long, steep, downhill, kind of a dry creek bed. I like to sprint down there. So I was sprinting down this creek bed and another rock, and I flew this time. And it's quite a crash. And it was utterly silent. In the forest, birds, squirrels, snakes could not have cared less. You know, it was impassive. It was no judgment, no sympathy. Just me there, and I just felt a kind of peace. You know, it's hard to describe. And I looked down, and to my right, there was a cracked speedometer from a bicycle. Somebody had obviously wiped out there at another time. It was old, it was dusty, and it just somehow symbolized something to me about everything stops eventually. You know, you can measure it all you want. I don't know. So, okay, that was that. Okay, great. So another week or so passes, and I'm out running again in the same location. We're on up that hill. Instead of turning to the right, I turn left this time on the flat, grassy, easy part of the run. I tripped again. It's like, what, a blade of grass? I mean, what was that? My foot? I don't know what I tripped on. But I was flying again, and I just laughed. I said, really, again? And I hit and rolled the way I was taught to fall in judo, you know, when I took judo in college, and just roll right back up. And it was, you know, I didn't think this thought then, but I think now that was just Buddha sitting still. What else is that? We're in the middle of all our activity, in the middle of all it's going on, good and bad. There's just this sitting. So to get back to the koan a bit, the Buddha just sat still, and the non-Buddhist got it, praised him, thanked him, bowed and left. And then Ananda, who happens to be the Buddha's cousin and his longtime attendant, asked him, well, what did the non-Buddhist realize? What was that? And it's a great question. Great question. Once at Kinshikai, Migaku Roshi, reflecting on this koan, said, I think if I sat next to Shakyamuni Buddha, the system of I would be liquidated. I think that's what happened to our non-Buddhist. He dropped away. You know, that edifice of I, that house that we build, that seems to occupy us more than we occupy it, falls away. It's the same thing that happened to the Buddha under the Bodhi tree. And the non-Buddhist, so you got to feel happy for the guy, right? I mean, he must have danced a non-Buddhist jig all the way home. And Ananda saw that, you know, it's, he was, Ananda was selected to be the Buddha's attendant for good reasons. I might get into that in a bit, but he saw a lot of people come and go. And he witnessed, no doubt, a lot of awakening moments, but this one seems to have struck him particularly. And so why? You know, what did he realize? And the Buddha's answer, he's just like a fine horse that runs even at the shadow of a whip. Great in itself. This is an allusion to a simile that's in a sutra in the Pali canon, where horses of a different type are compared to or analogous to individuals who realize deeply the nature of impermanence. So the fine horse that runs at the shadow of a whip is compared to that person who hears of the grave illness of someone in a neighboring village and comes to this great insight about impermanence just from that news. And the horse that runs when the whip touches the hair, the hide, is likened to the person who comes to that awareness of impermanence when someone in their own village falls ill. And the person who, and the horse that runs when the muscle is hit by the whip, penetrates the skin, is likened to the person that awakens to impermanence when someone in their own family falls gravely ill. And finally, the horse that runs only when the whip gets to the bone, when the whip comes down, that's the person who finally realizes impermanence when they themselves fall gravely ill. I promise that'll be my last allusion to the rolling stones. You can't always get what you want. We get to that's the end of the koan. But another question that arises, what kind of horse are you? What kind of horse am I? And, you know, I don't think it matters. And can we become better horses? Yeah, I think so. Maybe we can be wild horses. But surely with practice, whatever kind of horse you are, it's okay. It's not a race. So the koan stops there, the case. And then Muman has a commentary, which I'll read. Ananda is Buddha's disciple, but his realization is less than the non-Buddhists. Now tell me, how far is the distance between the non-Buddhist and the Buddha's disciple? So this is kind of where I got off in my Madrid Teisha. I don't want to belabor this point. The difference between Ananda and the non-Buddhist is vast if you look at it one way, you know, person who has enlightenment, person who doesn't, but even the hair's breadth of difference is the distance between heaven and earth. But from the essential point of view, there's no difference. There's no difference whatsoever. Couldn't be. There's no difference between Ananda and the non-Buddhist, between non-Buddhist and Buddha, between Buddha and you, between you and the wall. Me and the wall. Nothing. No difference. So I think we can't, we should, I don't know if Muman's, you know, trashing Ananda or not, but Ananda's not a shrimp. We owe a lot to Ananda. I just got to talk about it for a second. As I said, he was selected for his incredible talent and gift of auditory memory. he could remember every word the Buddha said, even the inflections. And that became evident, and people kept asking him to be the attendant. Buddha had had several prior attendants. But he kind of resisted. He finally relented, and on condition. He had great character, and he had these conditions. He was praised for his morality and for his own articulateness, but he had conditions. So I won't be the attendant unless I don't get special treatment, and we'll go into all that. But I get to question the Buddha. I get to discern who he can see or who can see him and who can't. I'm going to protect his time. I'm also going to make sure that his teaching is available. So he did all that for us. And he also was instrumental, the most instrumental member of the Sangha in allowing women into the monastic Sangha. So we owe a great deal to Ananda. With apologies to Mumon's commentary, I think Ananda is pretty cool. So the verse, walking on the edge of a sword, running over a ridge of ragged ice, not using steps or ladders, jumping from the cliff with handspring. Walking on the edge of a sword. That's Buddha just sitting still. That's our practice. That's our precepts. Running over a ridge of jagged ice, the same. There's no time for hesitation, no time for pondering. Move straight ahead. Straight ahead runs the way. It's also about, it's about how we live. You know, it's about how you drive your car, about how you shop for food, about how you relate to your family, your friends, your neighbors, strangers. Not using steps or ladders. We are, we're not here to achieve another level and another level. Awakening is something that is spontaneous and, it's an event. It's not something that you gradually find. That's at least the Zen idea. And the, certainly, insight and awakening and enlightenment are nurtured and integrated into our lives over a lifetime. It's not something that we get in a stepwise fashion. And the final line, jumping from the cliff with hands free. Buddha, just sitting still. Non-Buddhist, falling away from that edifice of I, the cliff of I, me, mine, just jumping off of that. And what freedom, what freedom. I quoted that line at the reception because, it just feels like that here to be among you and to be embraced in this way. This is about liberation. This is about falling headlong into original love, to sing this phrase. The embrace of the whole universe, no separate self. Just Shakyamuni Buddha, the world honored one, sitting still. this meditation.